first speaker today is Dr. Rudy Schild, and Rudy is an astrophysicist and cosmologist at the Harvard Smithsonian Center for Astrophysics, and we've had the privilege of working with Rudy for many, many years, and most recently he's become the editor-in-chief of the online Journal of Cosmology, which if you haven't checked that out yet, it's a really fabulous online journal of all the greatest leading edge things in cosmology and all related fields, consciousness, and you know, you could spend years going through the wonderful articles and publications that are listed there. Rudy's doing a great job. So Rudy, we're happy that you're here today, and I'll just let you begin.
Mike, did you wish I should use the mic? Should we try without?
Can you hear me as well without the mic?
No.
Okay. You get the mic. So thank you all for coming. A fabulous day, of course. I'm sorry about the people arriving from the west against the bright sun. I think most of you came from more the east and the southeast, so I hope you had a lovely morning. And I'm so pleased that you're here to try to focus on the universe with me. I'd like to explain to you what modern developments in astrophysics are saying about the nature of our physical universe, because there's been a lot of development in these times, and I particularly want to tell you the kinds of things that I'm now hearing for the first time at international symposia. I attended the big one in Prague 3 weeks ago, and it's astonishing to me how developments in the study of quantum mechanics and the structure of the universe are mirroring very beautifully the things that we've always known about the universe. But it seems like scientists are the last to know that. It's astonishing that our popular culture is full of what I have often listed for you as the modern miracles. Let's see, open the projector. Gwen?
Yes?
Can we turn the projector on?
Sure.
Okay, I'll tread water. Our civilization, through its religion and cultural institutions, has long known that there are many things that are very, very difficult to explain with our science. I'm talking about things like telepathy. I'm talking about things like remote viewing, near-death experiences. What about ghosts and fairies in the garden? What about astrology? And I think you all know that science approaches them by ignoring them. Just 2 days ago, I saw on BBC News an article about how, some scientist has now proved that life, the near-death experience, is a result of oxygen deprivation in the brain. And therefore, science now has a convenient excuse for not talking about it anymore, just pretending it doesn't exist. It's just oxygen deprivation here. Also, you know that the O'Hare UFO sighting 5 years ago now, I suppose it is, was just a hole punch cloud.
Right. A what?
Hole punch cloud. Nobody ever heard of a hole punch cloud until they needed some excuse for not dealing with a UFO sighting over an active terminal and runway at O'Hare Airport at the busiest time of day, cited by many people in the airline industry operating aircraft and concerned about what interference of our airspace does this represent. And the FAA's position is it didn't exist. Okay, that's how our civilization deals with what I've now listed for you as the modern miracles. Past lives, near-death experiences, telepathy, UFO sightings, abductions, precognition, crop circles, remote viewing, astrology, orbs and balls of light, ghosts, parapsychological experiments, all of those things we deal with as they don't exist. That's the official science community's result. And I think you know that if I, as a working Smithsonian, Harvard Smithsonian scientist, raise my hand and say in the seminar room, well, what about the UFOs? I will not be invited to the seminar room. That is a science position. That's where we are. And what do we do about it? Well, science has brought to the table a bunch of interesting tools now. We're now talking in science about dark energy. We talk now about wormholes, black holes, and I hope to persuade you before the day's over that actually the magnetic variant of the black hole, called a MECO, magnetic eternally collapsing object, is really the thing that we want to talk about, because, you know, black holes has always been a theoretician's sport until now, but we're now actually making observations of them. And observations say that the thing the theoreticians talked about lacked the important magnetic fields that dominate the structure of the object, and they've missed the story. And then we have two different flavors of dark matter. Actually, this is now discovered. Dark matter, we now see its light, and so there's been a sea change in the study of dark matter. Okay, so you're my guy. So,
I am your thing.
Thank you, Don. Now, I want to show a picture of what is turning out to be the nature of the structure that black holes make. However, the object here is not technically a black hole. This is a neutron star. And it has excited this nebulosity in the death throes of a star. Had this star been a little bit more massive, it would have actually made a black hole. And we therefore infer that the structures made by the black hole are very similar. And Don, if you can go back two slides, backwards, the other one. And one more. This, is, which was to be my introductory slide, is actually what we are finding is at the innermost area of the black hole. I'm talking about, this is a tiny black hole here, and it is surrounded by this magnetic field, which I've just shown schematically because you can't see it. Everything else on this slide is visible. It emits light, and we have detected the light from it. Also seen on this are the jets, which come out of the poles. The black hole is rotating this way. It is called a MECO, magnetic collapsing unit, but you will occasionally hear me slip into the word black hole, but for the rest of this talk, I mean a MECO, the magnetic variant. And what's happening is that the magnetic fields now abrade against the inner edge of what's called the accretion disk. Now, the accretion disk is junk falling in from space, and it's represented by this kind of disk of matter here, and I don't mean this structure. I mean a kind of a dark disk the artist showed on the intersection here. And that matter is attracted by the enormous mass of this thing, which weighs 3 billion times that as much as the sun. And that matter is trying to spiral in, we say in spiral, to the central object. But what happens is that the magnetic field of the spinning central object blows it back out into these wind structures, which are shown here in the deep blue. And these wind structures then are what are seen in optical telescopes. We see where the black hole objects or the magneto object is shining on them in the outer part. And so we see a luminous inner part and a luminous outer part. And that's what we actually see. And from that, we can infer that there must be the magnetic field, or else you wouldn't have this wind structure. The wind structure would not arise without the magnetic field. I belabor this for you because it's extremely important in the understanding of what this object does in the universe, and in particular, how it activates consciousness. This object, at the center of every galaxy, and also many sprinkled throughout the galaxy in the hundreds, is the seat of those quantum waves which people have always known describe particles in the quantum mechanical theory that I hope some of you are studying at university. But also we're discovering, as I also heard at Prague, that consciousness is probably also part of this study. And the consciousness aspect is studying not the round spherical part of the wave, but actually a spiral part. And in the discussion of quantum mechanics, if you want to explore that literature, you will hear it described as helicity, or you will hear discussion of helimagnets. And physicists are now discussing the quantum states of helimagnets. But getting ahead of myself a little bit, Wilhelm Reich was talking about that all along when he was talking about orbital energy and talking about consciousness. That's getting ahead of myself. One more. I want to show you how prevalent this structure is. This is the same structure. These are the outflow structures. I had inferred these structures from observations made with large telescopes the size of this room. But we now can see these in many of these neutron star analogs to the black hole objects. The reason that the neutron star analogs are less outrageous to physicists is we've always understood that neutron stars can have magnetic fields. People have always speculated that black holes cannot. That's a failure of the old black hole theory. So Don, next one please, shows another similar object. Here you see partly projected, the two outflow structures, the big balls, and here is the neutron star at the center. I haven't dotted in here the magnetic field structure. Next, please. Another one of these structures where you don't see the two dumbbells so well, there is a faint star in here, and you see the cylindrical cavity that this has produced, again showing that a round object with a magnetic field can make a cylindrical structure in space. Don, the next one. Here is a very interesting one where I presume the object is seen at more of an inclined angle. This would be the central star, fairly new one. It is still bright. It will in time gradually fade. And those of you who have a favorite position to see the screen will see there are faint little shells suggesting that this put out successive puffs of mass, which are now illuminated by the central object. And Don? In this case, we see the object apparently pole on. In other words, we're looking down at its axis. This is just an accidental foreground star. It has nothing to do with it. This is the neutron star. And again, you see it now, but it will gradually get dimmer. And Don? I believe this is the last one, and this one looks more like the first one. It looks more like my sketch. This is the neutron star. This is the double bubble, and the two intersecting bubbles, and the accretion disk matter is along the plane here. So again, the same physics, matter falling from the outside crashes into all of this, gets caught in an orbiting plane, and gradually tries to spiral to the central object. And I believe there's one more, which I don't have a clue of what this is. So, just lest you think I have all the answers, this is my humble statement that, well, there are some things yet to be explained. Here, it's nicely seen that you can see, it's rather edgewise, this accretion disk plane, the plane where all the junk is falling to it. The star at the center is obscured by the dust and dirt in this thing. Somebody should clean this out. And then it's producing a double structure, and it might be that these are two jets, or this is a hypothesized X-wind. Needs more work. Don, please. Now, I want to go back and tell you why you're excited about this, not a black hole, it's a Vigo object. It's because of the following property. When the universe forms these objects, they're typically formed by a bunch of gas in the universe which is dynamically unstable and collapse from its own weight. That's the standard picture. The new picture is that this collapse does not produce an infinite density event horizon. And the event horizon, presumed at infinite density, is the thing that has confounded all mathematical treatments of this until now. because mathematics just goes bonkers when you try to go through an infinite density. You can't talk about the continuity of magnetic fields and electric fields and so on through an infinite density boundary. And if you read the literature, and in particular the controversies between Steve Hawking and Leonard Susskind, if you pick up those books, you will put them down real quick because they are so esoteric that I can't understand them, or I don't believe them. My God wouldn't make that universe. So what happens instead is that when this thing is collapsing, quantum mechanics saves the object from making infinite density. What happens is that spontaneous pair creation, that is electron-positron pairs, form and almost instantly unform, but in their formation and during that microsecond in which they exist, they create a pressure sufficient to stop the infall. And so you get, instead of an infinite density surface, you get a very high density, very high pressure, very high temperature, very high quantum effects surface. The surface that you get is extreme in every property that nature knows how to make for us. Extremes of, as I said, temperature, density, magnetic field strength, quantum effects, extremes of everything. And that means also they are logically the home of extremes of quantum mechanical behavior. And these are the places which many people have often intuited must exist and called them white holes. So where you have a black hole, you actually have a white hole of this dark energy. And that's where the quantum effects reside. So a black hole in mass universe is actually a kind of a white hole in spiritual space or quantum mechanical space. Same thing. And I'd like to explain to you how they are so important in our understanding what is it in the universe that stores memory, because it will turn out that these objects are nature's hard drives. They store all information of the history of the universe. And this happens in the following way. If matter is trying to fall onto this surface of this MECO object, it will take a large amount of time for the matter to fall halfway from wherever it is to this surface or to the center of the object. And we're going to do a kind of a Zeno's paradise argument, if you know what that means, or if you remember that. Then, for the matter to fall another halfway, an interesting relativistic effect comes up called time dilation. The matter seen locally falls in a reasonable amount of time, but the distant observer sees it highly redshifted, and with high redshift comes time dilation, so it takes a very long time for the distant observer to see this happen. So that takes maybe a million years to happen. And to fall halfway again now takes 100 million years, and to fall halfway again takes the age of the universe, or 10 million years. And so the infall seen by the distant observer never falls in entirely. And so the material is piled up and it is seen by the distant observer at all different redshifts. So that even if you shine a laser to this thing, well, the laser will approach the object, but as seen by the distant observer, it will gradually become redshifted more and more and more and move slower and slower and slower and never really get in there. So the surface, because the light propagation speed exceeds the age of the universe, the distant observer at light speed cannot be in contact with the contents, the interior solution, or the interior state of the black hole, MECO. So to summarize, the observations that we are making today indicate that the object is dominated by its global magnetic fields. We see that in the structures that emit light from the object. The collapse does not happen to the classical event horizon that everybody's talking about. Instead, it's stopped by these quantum mechanical processes of pair production. And now something new I want to tell you about is what also comes out of this thing, because this is where we get what are called emergent properties entering our universe from the inside of the object. Now I told you that nothing crosses this boundary as seen by us, the distant observer, because the time it takes is too long and relativistic time dilation forbids it. However, other things in the universe propagate faster than light. No booing, please. I understand you heard the first day of graduate school that nothing goes faster than the speed of light. I heard that too. I heard it from Nobel Prize winner Chandrasekhar. He was one of my professors at the University of Chicago. However, experimentally, we know that quantum effects propagate faster than the speed of light. And not a little bit faster. They've been measured at 10,000 times faster than the speed of light. And they just can't be measured faster than that because it's too difficult a technical challenge. Remember, you can't send the laser signal anymore to measure this thing because it's happening faster than the speed of light. And so you have to do it with carefully calibrated atomic clocks and all that complicated stuff. It has been done. It has been shown that two particles whose quantum mechanical states are correlated because they recently collided can be measured at distances 60 miles apart from each other, and the spin change that accompanies these particles can be detected at 10,000 times the speed of light. So forget what they speculated about 30 years ago or even 10 years ago. It's now experimentally confirmed, not by me, by European scientist Szilard, if you want the name, as observationally correct. Now, this being the case, objects traveling much faster than the speed of light, and perhaps instantaneously, we now understand that we can be in contact mentally and as quantum states with the contents of the black hole. We also know that the black hole is in the spiritual space, or into this quantum space, is a white hole. In other words, it's a very powerful source of something, quantum information of all kinds. And as such, it might be a place where any cosmic intelligence guides our universe. Is this getting interesting? It might be, and probably is, a place and a machinery for cosmic intelligence to be actively guiding our universe. So, for example, when we go to church and pray, what happens to that prayer? As information, it can go to the interior of the black hole at the center of our galaxy. And if some cosmic intelligence wants to answer that prayer, it could do it. And we have long known in quantum mechanical theory that the universe always seems to be giving us these emergent properties. And emergent properties is a way of saying, but we can't really know anything more about them because they're too complicated. So emergent properties, in the shortest version, is butterfly flaps its wings and 3 days later there's a thunderstorm in Siberia. We can't trace in detail what happened to those minute little fluctuations in the atmosphere that joined with other effects of other butterflies and dragonflies and the other flies and passing automobiles and passing airplanes. all of those combining together in an incredibly complex maze of inputs, which eventually, however, produce a thunderstorm over Siberia. So in science, we deal with this by just calling it emergent properties. Things that are so complicated that we can't find simple cause and effect relationship to plug into our computer as inputs and predict what these outcomes will be. Now, I also want to, with my next slide, tell you a little bit about an important aspect of quantum properties that we see in the universe. And I'm calling attention here to the simplest experiment that they do at CERN and we have done since the 40s era with our cyclotrons and bevatrons and betatrons and all that. And the simple process is we take a particle like a proton seen here and collide it with a proton here and then observe the collision, which is a recoiling photon or a proton or whatever the collision does. The key point here is that in such a quantum process, the outcome is never 100% certain. We don't ever know, is this going to produce simple recoil? And if it is recoil, what will be the angle of recoil? We can do as a fairly simple quantum mechanical process, in fact, left as a homework student, a homework project for the student. Compute what's the probability of the particle recoiling perhaps in this direction, which is the most likely direction, but it's also true then that it might recoil in a slightly different direction, or might be recoiled in this other slightly less probable prediction. But we can never predict exactly what direction it will be. That's what we call the uncertainty principle. There is always uncertainty in any quantum mechanical process. And the problem is then we can never talk about exactly what will happen and put all the equations in a computer and get an exact outcome. But now you have to ask yourself this question. Okay, I do this experiment just once. One proton colliding with one other proton, and I measure an angle 33.4 degrees. Now, ask yourself, who or what in the universe decided it was going to be 33.4 and not 35.4 and not 32.7? And of course, we can't know that answer. And that's why science always has to go back to emergent properties. There are fundamental quantum mechanical limits to how perfectly we can predict outcomes of experiments. We can set limits to those uncertainties, and we call that the uncertainty principle. And yet, if you think about a simple quantum mechanical process, there is an outcome, and you are now left with the choice of deciding, well, it's just a statistics table, and all of these outcomes are by a probability table, and the outcome of any individual experiment is just a random thing governed by statistics. Or you might go the route of saying, well, if there is a cosmic intelligence guiding things, this is where that guidance enters the universe. We discovered the limits of what can ever be considered known and what you have to ultimately ascribe to some cosmic intelligence if it exists. If we could go back this time, so reverse. Thank you. So black holes now are likely to, I'm sorry, MECOs are now likely to be the most powerful source of these emergent properties. Things that we can't explain that are happening in our universe. And if you want to put a religious tie to it and say, this is the home of the Creator, fine, your call. I, as editor of the Journal of Cosmology, have the problem that we, trying to describe the quantum mechanical universe, have to talk about these things. This comes up in science discussion. And so we are asking ourselves, do we use the G-O-D word, or what word do we use? And we have settled on a term that was first suggested and used by Fred Hoyle 30, 40 years ago, cosmic intelligence. But you put your own spin on that. That's not what we're talking about here. So I've already said then that the black hole Miko objects are a place for the creator to influence and guide the creation. And also, because of this redshift property and time dilation, these become the place in the universe where all information and knowledge is stored. Next again. Now, the next step in this process is to explain to you how the universe processes information that is stored as quantum waves. And the biggest progress in this was made by scientist, astronaut, Apollo 14, Dr. Edgar Mitchell, who was very interested in this topic after his moon and moon transit experiences, and formulated the quantum hologram idea. And if you want to read all about this, he has a paper with Robert Staritz on Journal of Cosmology's springtime 2011 issue. In other words, if you want to write down Journal of Cosmology, issue 14, volume 14, and it's for April and May 2011. He lays out the entire formulation of how, apparently, the universe stores and transmits information about our human emotions, our existence, and the existence of everything in the universe as these quantum waves. Now, what he's saying is not very different from what quantum mechanics experts in Europe, principally, devised in the 1920s era. That every electron, every proton in the universe is described by its quantum wave. Nobody has ever been able to talk about what field that wave exists in. Some people are now thinking that it's kind of a very ether-like substance in the universe, and we're wondering about its relationship to dark energy. I have a slightly different spin on it that I'm working on with mathematicians in Europe. And I hope that I have time to talk to this, to talk about these items. But I'd like the next slide to just show you one key element to this, and this is what's going on in the brain, with the brain's resonance with these objects. The details of what's going on in the brain exactly in interacting with this field had also been described in the Consciousness edition of Journal of Cosmology. So again, 2011, Journal of Cosmology, the issue for April, May, a fabulous article by Sir Roger Penrose and Stuart Hameroff, the experts in this field, describing how microtubular structures in the brain become quantum receivers and transmitters of the hologram field or of the quantum mechanical energy field. The brain then makes images of the phase relationships or the structures of quantum information, and so the brain creates these brain waves that have been now registered in many schemes of brain study, and Edgar Mitchell describes them as being the vehicle that, at faster than the speed of light, transmits information all around the universe, and this then is the technology that describes what I showed you on the first slide, which is the modern miracles. This machinery of the universe, described by Edgar Mitchell, described in the brain by Penrose and Hameroff, and described in black holes by me, now forms the structure that describes that enables the modern miracles, and maybe in future events with Mindshift Institute, we'll go down the table of astrology, remote viewing, and all of those things, what those are. Next slide, please. Now, in the classic development that I've shown you here is a slide, and I think this is not to be taken too literally. But I think that what's happening here is that we, the human creature, are right here. This is the human being with his spinal column antenna and with his left and right hemispheres of his brain, left and right hemispheres. We've always talked about the right side being resonance with what is, has biblically always been called soul, and which is the part of our being that's eternal. And every mother knows that the two children were raised alike, but they're different as night and day. They seem to come into the world with something, and we call that soul. And it appears that the right brain, there's a principal resonance, as I had described, with quantum holograms with soul. And we don't know what the relationship of soul to the cosmic intelligence is. We have a sense that the left side of the brain, the left lobe, resonates with logic and reason in the universe, with body inputs of fit, of pinch and smell and hearing and sight, and that this becomes resonant at the surface of the object. I've drawn here the magnetic field to remind you that you have this surface that's acting as nature's hard drive, and the interior space then is this kind of white hole object of unknown relationship to the cosmic intelligence. And the black hole then has this unknown, we can call it, we talk about it in our civilization as a wormhole, I talk about it as wave surfing relationship to cosmic intelligence. Next slide. I think we, this is enough redundant with the previous at the same time. Let's go on to the next one. Because I want to tell you what's really exciting you. And Michael, how much more time should I spend?
Yeah, almost 10, 12 minutes.
10, 12 minutes. Thank you, that should do the job. I've already mentioned to you that in Prague, scientists were already discussing the fact that there seems to be helicity in the universe, and you will find this in titles of scientific reports that say quantum states of Hilbert magnets, if you want to explore this deeper with internet searching and so on. The waveform that we have dealt with described particles tends to be approximately spherical or round waveforms that kind of converge on the particle itself. However, when you think about the space that exists for such waveforms to exist that we always believed since the 1920s era, we're now waking up to the fact that there should be another kind of wave that exists, and that would be one that has a rotational or a spiraling property. And to help your imagination, I brought a little something. Does it help if I show it in the light here? To just remind you that we're talking about something that has a vorticity to it, and that is has a kind of a spinning aspect to it, but advancing at the same time. Now, we're here in Rangeley, Maine, where the orgone theory was developed and described by Wilhelm Reich 50 years ago. And if you read his books and his descriptions of orgone energy, you will see again and again he showed a little spiraling wave. How did he know that? He was not a classically trained astrophysicist or physicist or quantum mechanics expert or any of the kind, and besides, those fields hadn't been talking about such things at the time. It is so criminal that the man died in prison and his library burned when he was simply 50 years ahead of his time. He had already come to understand by some kind of channeled knowledge that came to him from the universe somehow that intelligence and knowledge come in waves in the universe, and science is the last to know. Now, I'd also like to tell you a little bit Yes, all right. So the quantum waveforms describing particles as spherical waveforms used until now also can have a helicity index, and I think Ron is here somewhere. He will know that I'm talking about the curl of these wave states. This would cause them to resonate with these Penrose Pamaroff grain microtubules described in the Journal of Cosmology, and Wright had always stressed that this should be the case. Also, if I can hold up my spiral waveform again, I want to point out that if you look at it a little bit from the side, it describes a figure that we call a cycloid. So if it's doing something like this, that you will also find in Wilhelm Reich's book. And also, you will sometimes see that he drew it this way. That is, pointed up or pointed down. I also know that from my attending a gathering of Native American elders here in neighboring Vermont 2 years ago, in their most sacred ceremony, they hold up crystals. The chief priestess of the Cherokee Nation holds up very large crystals and talks about ascending and descending spirals being life in these crystals. So, we have always known these things. Scientists are the last to know. Next slide. So, I want to take you on a little mathematical interlude because some of you, I hope, are curious enough to look some of these things up on the internet or explore them in books. I don't recommend that you ask your science professors about them. They won't know what you're talking about. However, I want to say that what appears to be emerging now as the correct mathematics of all of this is the following. We have always described the Einstein universe with four dimensions of space and time, x, y, z, and time. But what appears is that now we're starting to see that these dimensions are actually complex numbers. They have an imaginary part to them. So that x is actually x naught e to the I omega sub xt. In other words, there is a phase relationship in these principal dimensions x, y, z, and t. And that that such a structure has been understood previously in mathematics. It's called a manifold of complex dimensions. And it has even been called a Stein manifold from a Max Stein, who did the most to describe them. And of course, mathematicians in their way will then consider all of the mathematical implications of this. Are these differentiable? Can you do integrals over such a space and all of these mathematical complexity? Fine, done. You can look them up. Now, what's going on in the brain? Don't forget, the brain has two hemispheres, left and right hemispheres. If the quantum waves of our consciousness are complex numbers, and if the brain can resonate with the universe, a la Penrose and Hammerstein, and if through the hypothalamus it can generate the phase conjugate version of the same wave, and because the brain is electrically operated and doing cross-correlation between these two waveforms, the numbering, multiplying or correlating a wave by its complex conjugate creates the real component of that wave, and that is then the thing that appears in the brain as electrical activity. In other words, the brain of humans and animals with its spherically mirror structure can bring into realization, into reality, phase structures that pervade our universe in the Stein manifold. there's a mathematics of this now. And the brain is the quanta in the universe that can not only receive this phase information, but also create it and transmit it by this machinery. So I wrote here in a sober moment. So the correlation, that is the multiplication and superposition and multiplication of the two forms, including the complex conjugate in this wave, express then the realization of the wave, and it then comes in the brain as electrical activity, and thereon proceeds to the body to coordinate activities and be your consciousness. Then, this gets really hairy and mathematical, and I didn't attempt to write the mathematics of this because, as Stephen Hawking's editor says to him, for every equation in the book, you lose 10,000 meters. But there is a way of writing this in a Lorentz invariant machinery that expresses the strong principle of equivalence so that this concept actually becomes the relativistic quantum field theory of gravity that also involves consciousness. You'll recall that Einstein, to the end of his life, in the last 30 years, was looking for the relativistic quantum field theory of gravity. How could he have ever guessed that it involves consciousness? But don't forget that Wilhelm Reich paid him a visit, Einstein listened, but rejected what he was trying to say. Next and final slide, I believe. The final thing, remarks I want to make, are a few aspects of this. So I've already explained how the two halves of the brain receive, duplicate, and transmit quantum holograms, all the information in the universe. It's these helical shaped coil-like waves that Reich was already tapped into and describing that seem to be providing and describing all conceptual thought. The brain creates them, the universe transmits them, as Edgar Mitchell described, and the MECO processes them. The black hole object MECO processes them. They penetrate all speed, all space. They propagate much faster than the speed of light and probably instantaneously. And this process is the one that enables all the modern miracles. If some of you are particularly interested in one of these modern miracles, I will be here for the next day and a half and be glad to talk to you about how this machinery in particular enables the modern miracle of your choice of flavor. But there is now a theory for all of that stuff. Thank you very much.